I don't have my co-presenter here, Sudhindra Murthy, so unfortunately he couldn't travel. So I'll start myself. My name is Anand Palaniswamy. So I manage a cloud networking group for both eBay and PayPal. So that includes SDN, Neutron, LBS, and DNS. So for both these companies. So I just want to go over, of course, you know this very well about our company. So how critical it is when you talk about networks and then virtual networks or the physical networks, because it's a serious business we are talking about. It's not just, IT infrastructure we are talking about. Sure, and this is our cloud today. And this is being shared in multiple presentations maybe already. And just want to go over before we get into what we are talking about in terms of cloud networking and SDN. So currently, I'm talking about only this OpenStack cloud. Of course, our infrastructure is much more bigger than what we are talking about here. It's a journey to migrate towards this. So currently we have around 8,500 hypervisors and of course, 70,000 VMs and a lot of, block storages and thousands of internal cloud users. And mid-2015, it will be around 10,000 hypervisors. So if you look at the deployment architecture itself, so I want to go through, in terms of, how we deployed it, and then I want to drill down individually, actually, how we have deployed, specifically SDN, where it fits in, so that actually it will give you a perspective of where things are and then how, we are moving forward in terms of, scaling it out. So if you look at, the deployment itself, right, so we have multiple regions in the geographical regions, and every region has, multiple availability zones. And then every availability zone, internally we deploy, OpenStack. Of course, if you look at the region itself, we tie all of these regions together using a global keystone. So if you look at it as a single cloud, but every region is being independently orchestrated. Even if something happens to OpenStack in one particular region or availability zone, we don't impact the business. Even that particular region or availability zone goes down. It's not like, other, some of the enterprise clouds actually sometimes everything goes together, but we architected in a way it perfectly fits. Okay, even if you want to do some maintenance in the core, we take out only that particular availability zone for maintenance. And of course, we have redundancy everywhere in the switches and routers and then cores or wherever, but sometimes actually you might, get into some critical infrastructure upgrade, then we need to take out some availability zone of that traffic. If you look at actually, we kept all those things in mind before we decide to go and deploy cloud in the production, right? It's not that actually we just deploy somewhere and then it didn't work, and then after that actually we take a huge hit and it impacts the business. That's more critical than not deploying OpenStack, right? And if you look at actually every availability zone is a fault domain, right? It's very key in the design. So earlier days, when you talk about an application, hey, my application needs to have this particular availability, but I need to distribute across multiple fault domains within the racks actually, okay. I cannot have my VM under this particular half rack or maybe quarter rack or whatever, I need to distribute everywhere. No, your application needs to scale across availability zones. Even the availability zone goes down, as I mentioned, it should not take any impact to the business. So, and you might very well end up in the same half rack if you don't have enough capacity in other places. What's the flavor that you're looking from the Nova? And you have to account for all of that. You cannot guarantee, okay, my application will be always being in multiple racks and then multiple switches and multiple wall domains in that layer, not at the rack level. It's all over availability zone. And when I talk about availability zone, it's thousands of hypervisors, right? So availability zone maps to more than one physical network bubbles. That's key as well. So basically, when we design bubbles, sometimes what happens is based on your network infrastructure gear that you bought it in the past, you might not be able to fit your availability zone scale into a single bubble. There'll be more than one bubble, but all these bubbles are tied together in a single availability zone, right? So what does that mean? Basically, if you are doing a maintenance at the bubble level, you have to be really, really careful because your availability zone is compressing up multiple bubbles. So that's very key. But the newer availability zones that we are deploying, we might end up going into the one bubble to one availability zone. But that has a lot of implications into the existing data centers, how you deploy, right? So, and then to scale it out with an availability zone, we have multiple Nova cells. When I talk about actually every availability zone will have several thousands of hypervisors, it is not easy to manage with a single cell. We have to get into multiple cells. I'm going to talk more about that in the next slides. Sure. So I'm double-clicking on the single availability zone, right? We went into the region, and then from the region, we went into the availability zone, and then, of course, everyone knows how to deploy the cells. And then every cell, actually, I'm talking about the racks fit in within the cell, right? And we have our, you know, of course, I'm talking about from the end-user perspective, if you are in eBay and PayPal customers, you know, of course, you are coming from the internet. When you come from the internet, of course, you know, you will hit our, you know, one of the firewalls and then edge routers. And after that, actually, I'm talking about only within the aggregation where cloud meets, okay, the public traffic, or maybe internal traffic also, right? Your cloud starts from there, and I'll talk about actually, and first of all, you know, when I talk about SDN, a lot of people for only overlays SDN. Some people, you know, they don't consider this as SDN. And for me, actually, SDN is an API to operate your network infrastructure. It could be overlay, it could be underlay, or maybe you're touching core, or access layer, or aggregation layer. And of course, Neutron doesn't have all those APIs yet, and we need to build all those APIs when you're talking about Neutron as the network as a service, right? So if you talk about aggregation layer, it's a three-tier, you know, architecture here. And then our access layer is nothing but, you know, your top of rack switch. And these are all the racks, actually. So if you look at, you know, this picture, you know, every availability zone, right? There'll be multiple, you know, tens of, you know, thousands of racks, you know, sitting together. And the last piece is very critical. It is also attached to the aggregation layer itself, but it is also gas top of rack switch, and SDN gateways, load balancers, and firewalls, they are all sitting there. But the rest of the infrastructure, everything is identical, right? And we could even talk about, okay, why do we even have to have, you know, load balancers and then, you know, firewalls in a specialized rack? Because they're cattle. They're not cattle, actually, right? They're puppies. You need to special, you know, special rack. And what happens, actually, if you don't have enough space and power to add more and more, you know, load balancers and firewalls in there? So that's where actually things are getting really, really interested. Now, why can't we move firewalls and then, you know, the load balancers as virtual instances within the compute racks itself, right? And have only maybe these gateways and stuff like that in the specialized racks. And of course, it's based on the throughput that you want to get out of your each and individual, the advanced services that you have in your data center. And that defines actually whether you can move it or not. And that is always a question, okay. Okay, what will happen actually, you know, you can scale out your racks, but if you can't fit, you know, all our, you know, advanced services from layer 4 to layer 7, there is no enough space and power, right? Of course, you can't extend data center within a day, right? So what happens for that? So if you look at actually, this is what happens inside an AZ. This is our availability zone. And here, if you talk about within availability zone, of course, now we have the entire OpenStack deployment lives in, right? Your Keystone, Nova, Nova cells, and then Cinder, you know, object storage, everything lives in within particular availability zone, right? And an availability zone, of course, it's tied to a region, right? And then we have some regional services, okay? And then regional services, you know, sits in the, you know, global Keystone that orchestrate across, you know, all over our regions and multiple geographical regions, right? So on top of that, actually, you know, when we talk about, you know, SDN, the important concept that we introduced to meet our business needs is virtual private cloud. Of course, you know, some of the public cloud providers already have an API to create, you know, virtual private cloud, and OpenStack doesn't have APIs to do that yet. But we have a business need to do that, and we introduce all these, you know, concepts within our, you know, our own patching with what we have internally. Of course, you know, we have an APIs also for that in, you know, multiple components that needs to cater this particular, you know, solution. So VPC, if you talk about, right, virtual private cloud, and then it comprises of, you know, multiple resources that you, you know, group together, okay? A business unit or maybe a business function within an enterprise, okay, you have specific requirement where I cannot share the traffic between other, you know, business functions. You want self-contained in terms of networking, in terms of storage, in terms of compute, right? How you isolate them? And of course, you know, you don't want to put firewalls everywhere. That creates an island for you, right? And you, if you want to move away from that, actually, you have to rewire your, you know, infrastructure, right? So if you file a site secret, if you're, you know, managing a larger infrastructure, you have to file a site services, and then they will take 2 or 3 days of SLA, and they move the racks, and then recable, reconfigure your, you know, top of rack, or maybe, you know, put it in a different VLAN. You know, think about actually how much time it takes for you to, you know, move capacity from one place to other place, right? So that's where actually, you know, I'm sure actually all of you know about SDN, actually what it solves, And you know, here, actually, very important for us, the VPC is very dynamic, where the capacity needs to move from one business to other business. Sometimes, actually, you know, in a business, what happens is, okay, you buy $100 million worth of, you know, gear, and the business shrinks down or whatever, or maybe it expands, so you have to expand dynamically based on your business growth, right? That's what actually, when I talk about actually, you know, the agility is very important for the business, and the, you know, scaling the infrastructure network is very key for that, right? So VPC is a security zone. As I said, actually, it's a self-contained, and it has its own security rules. And within the security zone, actually, every VPC is being firewalled off, of course, right? And you cannot talk through, you know, some of the ports or maybe some of the, you know, networks. You can't reach directly. There are, you know, multiple policies are enforced around VPC. But within VPC, you can still use fine-grained using security groups. Okay, within VPC, you have multiple applications, and then you want to set up some ports, and then open some ports, or some, you want to allow certain protocols. So you can do all sorts of things within using, of course, you know, OpenStack security groups itself, right? And again, you know, to introduce the VPC, you know, we had to make changes to Keystone, right? So basically, you know, when I talk about Keystone itself, right, every VPC will have multiple projects, and there is an admin project. He owns all these resources. Underneath, we have a lot of, you know, other tenants. They are inheriting all these resources capabilities. For example, you know, if there is a DNS zone, only the VPC says, okay, say suppose it's a wallet, okay, mobile wallet, right? It's a pay person of the application, and it could be and it might be living within one particular, you know, virtual private cloud, and they all share the same DNS zone. But of course, you don't want to give control to every application owners to manage that particular zone. So it will be managed only the tenant, admin tenant in that case. So we got to make changes to that. And of course, you know, there are multi-tenancy model. You know, what happens is, you know, within that particular VPC, we wanted to have, you know, one, you know, big routing domain, right? So what happens is within VPC, you don't want to have, you know, any latency, right? Of course, I'm going to be talking about some of the challenges that we face later. And we have, you know, big logical router that is spanning across, you know, multiple racks or whatever, and you logically carve out that. And we need to run that particular, you know, logical router that spans across multiple racks. And if you want to add, actually, you add the network, and it automatically, you know, still being, you are within that virtual routing domain itself. Right, and again, you know, what I'm going to be talking about is next. Actually, we need to have that, you know, stretched across multiple racks, that virtual switch or virtual routing domain. But okay, if you want to have a /16 network for that particular VPC, can you have a virtual router that could handle that many, you know, that much traffic? Right? What are the scaling limits? That's what we are going to be talking about. But what is the restriction that you have if you don't have that? That's what the next slides I'll talk more about it. Right, sure. So basically, you know, the challenges, you know, network design itself, right? So as I mentioned, right, okay, you have your VPC that you carved out. Okay, today actually we are running both overlay as well as bridge network. And overlay we run for, you know, some of the workloads. They are not latency sensitive, and also they are not, you know, it's okay to have some kind of workloads within, you know, small footprint. For example, you know, if you can have your virtual routing within /24 networks or /23 networks, then we can run the small router. It will scale for you. Say suppose again, when you're talking about /18, then you cannot have this because you have to go out and then come back if you, you know, want to go to the next network, right? And what will happen in that case is actually, you know, you have to hit the gateway, and then, you know, it is encapped, recap, and then you have to go back to the other switches and routers. So basically, it introduces the latency. So those cases, we don't use overlays. So basically, we go directly bridge, okay? So where, and also the security group, actually, you know, there are some limitations, actually, we had, actually, when you introduce more and more security groups in the OS layer, you know, how many flows that got introduced extra, and then what was the bottleneck that we had. I'm going to be talking about more and more about that as well. And also, you know, what will be the issues if you don't have the, you know, separate 100% separation between your SDN controllers and your data path. Okay, if you do some maintenance, if you get an outage of, you know, just upgrading the controllers, if it affects your data path, what will happen, right? So, and we had some challenges as well, I'll talk about that as well. And then what we want to do in future, okay, how we are going to be somehow solving some of our problems. Of course, they are all in the talks, and then we are going to be picking one of the solutions that we are discussing seriously internally, right? So this is what actually I talked about, little bit about in the previous slide, where what is the implications on the network design itself, what it introduces if your logical router doesn't scale beyond a certain point. Today, if you talk about the logical router, if you think about actually in the physical network, if you map this, this is your core layer, the logical router, and the logical switch is nothing but your top of rack switch. We came down to virtual networking now, right? And the VMs are nothing but your bare metal servers. If you map your physical infrastructure into this, that's how it looks like, right? But if you think about actually your logical router today, you bought it for so much of circuit capacity, right? Now you want to build another one because the capacity is not enough, and you'll be building multiple of that. So what else you need to buy to change that? Okay, your aggregation layer below that. So that's exactly the same challenge you are having it here, right? The logical router for us is slash 10 networks, right? And the logical switch is of course slash 24 because of some of the port limitations that we have in our SDN solution. They are all slash 24 today, right? So if you are running slash 24 and then every logical switch is slash 24 here, they're all connected to the logical router, right? Of course they are running an overlay. If you want to go out and then come back, you are getting the gateway, right? For example, if you're logical router to logical router, of course there will be latency, right? But if you're, suppose you are a VPC, if you're having multiple of these logical routers, you are introducing latency. That's one of the reasons actually we don't run the latency sensitive application into the overlay yet. But the ultimate goal is going to run everything on overlay, right? So that is going to solve our capacity problem that I touched upon before even start in the first or second slide, right? And so if you look at other one, the second router, if you get in there, actually you have to, that's extra hop. So in networking, actually every extra hop actually takes the time, takes extra latency, right? And let me talk about the gateway bottleneck itself. So what will happen here in this particular case, right? You are running Hadoop, okay? There are a lot of east-west traffic, okay? You are a tenant. You have, I would say, actually 500 node cluster. You are running in the cloud, right? And you don't have enough capacity within that particular logical router in terms of number of VMs. Actually, if you're talking about slash 20, you, of course, within the slash 20, you cannot pre-allocate to a particular tenant. And then later on, then no one will still have the capacity. If you are allocating, pre-allocating slash 20 for a particular tenant, and it's defeating the purpose of the cloud because you are reserving the capacity for someone. Now, if you look at the orange one, the red VMs, you have two VMs in the logical switch two, and then you have another one in one, and then you have one more VM across one more logical router. So it is introducing extra latency. So what we have done, some of the changes, to make sure that actually these workloads are being constrained within the same logical router, we change the Nova scheduler. If you are a tenant, and if you are, if you are already having 5 or 10 VMs in there, maybe 200 VMs in that particular logical router domain, just best effort you place within that logical router itself, but it is not the solution. So what happens actually, as I said earlier, if you don't have the capacity, you have to go somewhere else. So this is the reality that we are living in today, where the big data use cases like Hadoop and H2Os and a lot of chatty applications that we have, and we run all of them on Bridge today. Right. So security group, okay, this is an interesting piece that we debugged very, very hardly after maybe I would say 2-3 days. Actually, we don't know why the hell there are so many flows running in hypervisors, right? So what happened was, there are now self-reflexive rules that users get introduced. In our cloud, what happens actually by default, okay, every tenant lives in a particular VPC, they are all being firewalled up from other security zones. They're okay to run within that particular zone without shutting down some of the ports or what are some of the protocols. Sometimes what happens is there are applications, they want to shut down some specific ports, they want to run only on specific ports. So when you introduce all this security rules in a default security group, your flow table gets exploded. It introduces more and more flows within the hypervisor because you cannot summarize all of that, right? Then your controller, SDN controller, started managing so many flows, millions of flows, and it introduces a lot of load on your SDN controller. And if your SDN controller is not capable of handling those many, then you'll be in trouble. So what we have done for this, actually, you know, this is one of the reasons, actually, most of the time what happens is actually, you know, it is not able to use the Megaflow because your flow table you cannot summarize. Because say suppose when I say, you know, Megaflows, what I hope and everyone knows what Megaflows does. If it's not actually just touch on that. Say you have you're an application, right? Okay, this is a security domain where all these flows can talk to each other, right? All these flows, actually there will be only one flow. So summarize all of that and put it into a single flow. But if everyone has a different security group, you need to run a separate flow for that, separate path for that, for every security rule that you have, right? And it introduced, guessing that the number of flows are increasing, it introduces more and more memory footprint in your controllers again, because your table size increases, right? To simplify that, what we have done is actually, we took some of the patches in the community where, whenever you are the same tenant or maybe someone else, submitting the same rule and again, and instead of exploding them, you summarize all of that, you give that to your SDN controller. So that, because ideally, the SDN controller should do this job, because they should summarize internally, and then it needs to push those summarized flows, summarized security groups to the hypervisors. But here, actually, we took the job and then put it into the plugin, Neutron plugin, right? So that solved this particular problem. But still, somebody creates it, different rules that you cannot summarize, then you'll run into the same problem and again. Sure, this is another pain that we went through before. There is no separation between SDN control controller and data separation. So what happened was, okay, as I said, right, the millions of flows, that state is getting managed in your SDN controllers, right? And they are getting pushed into the hypervisors. Whenever you change, okay, you are creating VMs here, and then across the network you are creating somewhere else, then you have to plumb this, and controller manages the state where this particular hypervisor lands, and then where the other end of the tunnel. So what happens is, in this case, all these things are getting managed within controller, and when you upgrade the controllers, that's where the fun starts, you're restarting your controller now, because as part of the upgrades, and it needs to recalculate all these flows, and it has to send the newer version of the flows to the hypervisors. Then, to think about a scenario where you are connecting from VM A to VM B, you are one part of the tunnel calculated and you pushed to the hypervisor, but the other part of the tunnel still not being calculated, right? Because you are pushing the partial flow to the hypervisor. If you have a bug or maybe, then you're not talking about only one flow. There are millions flows like that. And if you are started pushing only the partial flows, then you get into trouble. Then, we took care of those kind of issues when you run at scale, these things happens, right? And that is one of the problem we faced most of the time during the upgrade. And another problem, big problem is, okay, there is no clear separation. Okay, what about actually you lost all your control cluster, right? Because the control cluster manages the entire flow state for the network, the entire mesh it manages, right? If it goes down, then your control data plane needs to stay as it is. Even though you're not going to get new flows into the mesh, but the existing flows needs to run as it is. But we didn't have that 100% separation. Because they periodically check the flow health, and then if it's not there or whatever, you take it out from the flow table. And we ran into a situation where we took a big hit actually when the controller went away, 2-3 controllers, because multiple controllers we run, and of course they are running with 256 RAM or whatever, and they all ran hard at some point because of the security rules that I talked about in the past, because there are multiple several millions of flow table got exploded. And even if it explodes, how you handle that in the data plane, it was not there earlier when we started, 3 years back. Now, all these features got introduced in our SDN controllers and the SDN gateways. Now we are at a better state, right? And one more thing is actually, the painful upgrades, okay? So you're upgrading your SDN controller. Now we are talking about several thousands of hypervisors, right? So earlier days, if you are talking about only upgrading the network, you talk about only the physical infrastructure, right? Your physical switches and routers, of course, it's not many, right? Maybe hundreds. Now your switch is moved to your hypervisor, right? This is what I was talking to a couple of my folks. Actually, you know, you're seeing a lot of pain because, you know, every upgrade takes, you know, 5 to 10 hours of upgrade window. Because, you know, it's taking live production, as I said, and you cannot just like that go and, you know, take a, you know, restart all OVS and all hypervisors. We have to batch it out and then identify actually the impact is very, very minimal. When I say impact, actually we are talking about only 10 or 12 seconds or 15 seconds max, the OVS restart. Even we can't afford that, right? And then that introduces, okay, lot of pressure on the OVS community. Whenever you reload a kernel, how much time you can afford? Can you make your data path run as it is and then swap the kernel? Or maybe, you know, within 1 or 2 seconds, can we restart that? So to avoid that, actually, we have to clearly, you know, identify all the hypervisors and then, you know, batch it in hundreds, maximum of 100 to 200 hypervisor in batch, and then run them as separate whenever you upgrade the hypervisors. Because now we are talking about upgrading, you know, thousands of virtual switches, right? So that introduces a lot of, you know, firefighting, and then, you know, sometimes, you know, there is a compatibility issues between the hypervisors and then, you know, what OVS version you are running, what kernel version you are running, because it's infrastructure grown over the period of time. You don't have, you know, the same version of hypervisor, same version of OS kernel running everywhere. There will be incompatibilities. How many things that you could test in your lab before you move to the infrastructure, real production, right? So these things were the real pain in running, you know, overlay-based and OVS-based, you know, infrastructure that we are running it currently. It's not about actually, you know, buying you know, controllers and then make it work for, you know, 100 hypervisors. But if you get into the real operating mode and they are really, really in a bleeding edge, the upgrade cycle is, you know, very often now. It's not like, you know, you buy your top-of-rack switch or core switch or core router, you upgrade, you know, yearly twice, right? You are upgrading, I'm talking about in monthly, you know, once or monthly twice, even very often actually, you know, bi-weekly or whatever. Depends on, you know, how many bugs and then how much maintenance that you need to do on this infrastructure. So for that, actually, no, we have to have really, really, you know, reliable, you know, software or maybe the orchestration software for during the upgrades. So that, you know, solved us a lot of problem in the later point of time, instead of having 10 or 15 hours of upgrade cycle. Now we reduced it to, you know, we could say around, you know, 5 to 6 hours we could do it effectively. Right? Right. So the gateway scale is used, okay? So if you talk about the logical router resides on a single gateway, right? Say suppose, you know, you are running a slash 20, our case is slash 20 network. We are talking about how many around slash 20, you know, network, those many VMs are being handled by a single gateway. Say suppose you are pushing gigabytes of data towards a single gateway. Of course, you know, we have active standby. Okay, something happens to this, actually it fails over to the standby within, you know, 10 to 15 seconds or 20 seconds that we have seen. But it introduces lot of, you know, latency when a lot of people are pushing more and more packets, thousands of packets per second. When you push it, you know, the single gateway doesn't scale, right? Now you need to distribute across multiple gateways, but we don't have that, you know, capability yet. Because as I'm going to be talking about actually how we are going to be solving that using some of the, you know, broadcasting, you know, technologies that we are talking about, right? And also we ran into a situation where, you know, our port security, you know, always scans across our infrastructure. They always send our packets, right? And we had a bug actually in our in our gateway. What happened was actually it is keep on increasing our you know, our packets in the queue. And after some point, actually, no, it choked the gateway. The entire traffic went down for an hour or so, right? Now, how you debug that? Because people will scan, right? And finally, it comes to a point, oh, yeah, we are running our, you know, physical network infrastructure for years and years, but even, you know, SDN, a gateway doesn't even, you know, hold for a simple scan. But the simple scan is being handled in a way that is, you know, the number of packets after some time, if you cannot process, just put it into the queue, and then the queue size has to be only very limited, maybe 1 or 2 packets. Why you want to queue up, you know, all the packets, and then you free up, you know, queue up your memory, or hit your memory, right? And of course, it's a bug, but that bug, how much impact it introduces in the infrastructure, that's what more important point is, right? And you know, we have to you know, introduce some of the solutions for that. Okay, I don't, because these are all you know, bugs that we are talking about. Of course, you know, to roll out this bug, we have to you know, get the you know, bug fixed and then you know, test it and then push it to the infrastructure. So until then, we have to run the infrastructure because it is taking production traffic, right? And we introduce some rate limiting scripts, actually identify all those you know, packets and you know, just rate limit them. Okay, if we are sending you know, from the same source, just stop them actually if it is more than you know, 3 or 4 packets. We introduce those things in the gateway, and then that is a stopgap that we introduce. And of course, those things are fixed by now. And also, we identified okay, who is sending this much of traffic? What is the source? Okay, and we identify the source IPs, source subnets, and we block them automatically. So that's the solution actually we identified initially to block it actually when we debugged and then rootcast, and that became a solution until we get the actual fix done, right? But identify this actually, who is the heavy hitter? Who is coming from where? Because in the infrastructure, because of the you know single the gateways running, the logical router and running on a single box. So we are all talking about okay, we are virtualizing, we are moving away from the physical switches and routers. They are all looking good, but if we cannot scale beyond on certain limit on x86, what we are talking about, it is not good. But there is a way you can you know scale out or distribute that we don't have today. That's what you know how we are going to be distribute on the x86 box itself to run you know several thousands of you know flows or several thousands of IP address for a particular VPC that we are talking about, right? And we wanted to distribute that. How we are going to be doing that? There are technologies, and you know that's what we are exploring it today, right? And other issues. Okay, now okay, we are talking about gateway, single gateway, how much latency we tend to use, and then what is the impact of running that particular /10T networks on a single router and sitting in a x86 box, right? Now we are talking about the AZ size itself, availability zone size itself, because a single control plane of SDN controller manages our availability zone for SDN controller, right? So it also has, as I said, right, the central control plane. It has to manage you know, millions of flows, and from multiple hypervisors, and how many hypervisors that central control plane could hold, right? And then we have a scale limit there too. But if you look at actually, you know, if I want to run my availability zone of only a couple of thousand or 2 or 3 thousand hypervisors, no. Because that introduces a lot of cost in terms of you know, building your stamping out your multiple availability zones. Because every availability zone, when I talk about, there are multiple bunch of other infrastructure services that you need to deploy. Money is one thing, and then time is one thing, right? Of course, you have automation, and you have to stamp out all of these things. And also, you know, every availability zone become an island after that. And if you want to tie all of that, you have to go to the core router and then come back. We don't want to do that. So instead, we wanted to scale out more than you know, 2,500 that we are talking about today, right? 2,500 is our availability zone in a scale. But we wanted to run at least 10,000, right? To run 10,000, if you have a central control plane, if you cannot handle more than 2,500 hypervisors, you need to scale out your SDN controllers itself. Then where do you calculate all these flows? Whether you calculate in the central controllers or you calculate in the hypervisors, there are you know multiple ways to do that. And you know, of course, you know, there's a journey that we started, and we are you know, sticking to that. And of course, you know, I'm sure actually we could get that goal very soon. Right, and again, there are a lot of concurrency issues in the Neutron that we ran into. Yes, exactly. I want to talk about that actually. So, what happens actually? Infrastructure is eventual consistent system. We all get it. But say suppose if you are creating 100 ports in Neutron, right? And you are, of course, you know, to scale out, you will be having a control cluster of you know Neutron control cluster. And your SDN controller also will be running under you know particular in you know, a group of cluster, and to hit the cluster, you will be maybe you know having a load balancer, virtual IP or whatever, right? You are hitting that, and based on the algorithm, it is going to pick one of your you know one of your controllers in that cluster. And how much time it takes for distribute that particular you know state change that you made on that controller to distribute to you know other nodes in the cluster. And you go to a node 1, and immediately you go to the node 2 because of the you know, round robin stuff, for example, if you're using our virtual load balancer, then it goes and hits the other node. But the state is not there. So what will happen is, okay, it will try to create another port. There will be you know, duplicate ports for the same IP. Right? So we ran into this issues, and then you know we depict so much on this actually, right? And they all worked until you know we had around 500 or 1,000 hypervisors. But when the scale started increasing, that's where actually we have seen most of the issues where people are creating you know lots of ports and lots of you know issues, and we had to you know. Fix all these issues in terms of you know how the controller is being load balanced across you know multiple nodes. And future enhancements. What we want to do is actually you know as I said actually the controller the gateways are running the routers are running on the single gateway. Of course, we wanted to advertise all these routes using BGP or some other mechanism. And also, our VPC is sitting within the same data center today. And then we wanted to you know extend that. You know, traffic across multiple data centers because if you are a VPC and then we want to have a seamless connection from you know data center one to data center, we are talking about EVPN and stuff like that. So now I think we are very close to the. Yeah, of course, you know there are so many challenges. We are keep hiring. If you are interested in being part of this, you know, solving this particular problem, you know, send me an email or you know connect me to my LinkedIn and we can always talk about. Okay, we got 5 minutes for questions. Maybe 10 minutes or 5 minutes. Yeah. So so when I talk about you know, all these challenges, right? So we started the journey 3.5 years back, and when we started 3.5 years back, actually we had only few set of technologies available those days, and we deployed it everywhere. And now we are looking at you know options how we can you know leverage VXLAN and then you know different options. Yeah, of course we are working on that. Yep. Yeah, we are with one of our partner actually. So we are using Nicira controllers. Yeah. So of course, you know, this is a journey. We started 3 years back and then we are in a much better state and you know than earlier. Yeah. Yeah, so the keystone changes actually earlier when we started in Folsom, right? We don't have domains and then hierarchical tenants and stuff like that. Basically, keystone changes is like you know VPC construct an admin tenant. That admin tenant owns all this you know networks belong to that particular VPC, right? So they can all talk each other, and that network is being firewalled. They're all belong to the same firewall domain. So we manage that particular information in the keystone metadata. Yeah. Yeah. No, we use Nicira. Nicira. Yeah. Any other question? Okay, sure. So if you guys have any questions or comments, and then send it to my email. Let's catch up. Yep. Thank you.